afternoon. I'm Rasesh Thakkar, and we are meeting here in the context of Kalanidhi open house that we have organized in the context of this upcoming festival. The whole idea of the open house was explained in the first meeting, but I'll just refer to it once again. That open house is a period of about 10 days to 2 weeks right before the festival. And live streaming technology that we have adopted allows us into a period that really extends both ways, a few days before the festival begins and a few days after the festival ends, so that actually the festival does not begin where it begins. It begins earlier. It does not end where it is, where it seems to be ending. It really lingers on for quite some time. How do we use the pre-festival period? Well, this 10-day period or the 2 weeks period that I'm referring to is going to really be very useful, because we want to bring the audience and the artists really together. It is in these early 10 days that we want a very warm introduction that we can give to the artists, and we want to form an informal group of the audience that will move with the artist all the way to the festival. Which means that we want the audience to be part of the festival. We want the audience to come and meet the artists. We want to interview the artists who are going to be participating in the festival. We want to talk about the structure of its programming, its logic, its interconnections. We want to show you visually the actual dances, or we want to show the dance career of the artist. We want to take you into her past. We want to talk about her training, her aspirations, her dreams, her visions. This way, we really feel that the audience will begin to know the artist from inside out. The audience will move in the last 10 days with the artist and with the evolving programming, so that by the end of the pre-festival period, the audience will begin not only to understand the art and the art form and the specific dance numbers which they are going to see in the festival, but hopefully they will begin to acquire a sense of ownership. They will feel that they have moved with the artist. They have made a suggestion here. They have made a comment there. And they will also begin to acquire a sense of belonging to what's going to happen. I think it, therefore, unlike in any other period in the previous festivals, we are going to have a much greater and closer contact between the artists and the audience. At the end of it, we'll have a truly educated, a cultivated audience, which is what we are hoping for. Today, I'm going to talk more about the logical structure of the programming. And I'm also going to talk about some of the basics, ticket buying and the various formats in which people will be able to watch the program. Because as I have said before, live streaming technology is going to be the heart of this festival. And that means that we are going to offer three different formats of viewing. There will be, like the traditional format, there will be the live dancing by the artists right on the stage, as we are all used to. But because of the use of live streaming technology, we are going to take that stage performance into distant locations, multiple distant locations. which means that you will be also, many of you, in distant places, or even in the city of Toronto, if you wish, you will be able to see the art in a cinema house such as a Cineplex, where the live streamed performance will be seen on a wide screen, and therefore you'll get a very different look and feel of the art. You'll be able to see minute details of the facial expressions, a twitch of the eye here, and a little finger moving there. All this will form part and parcel of the choreography. And Indian dance is particularly very keenly appreciated in its minute details. And then there is also the third form in which the live stream art can be viewed, and that is right in the comfort of your own home, on your personal devices. I'm going to talk about these three different modes of viewing and the three different price structures, and we are going to have to ultimately evaluate various strong and weak points of the three modes of viewing. But today I have a special event that I want to present to you. I'm going to begin to interview the artists. And I want to begin with a very special artist whom I have seen right from her childhood, I should say. And she has now become a very important part of not only Manaka Thakkar Dance Company's presentations, but the presentation of the entire festival. I mean Nina Jayarajan. So let me take you to a slightly different venue. Actually, it is the same venue, but a different location. And we are going to have a very fully satisfying and fulfilling one-hour interview. So Nina, are you ready? Okay, let's move. This is Nina Jayarajan that I refer to, the young, beautiful, and now not only in her career, but also in her motherly career, Nina Jayarajan. What I want to bring out here are so many different aspects of being a dancer, a mother, or also being a dancer in a genre that comes from, in some sense, another space. Nina is an Indian dancer. She studied with Manaka. I suppose you studied only with Manaka. We had some other students in our school, Nritya Kala, who might have studied a little before and then they might come in our school. But Nina is a completely, totally the Nritya Kala product. Nina has had several different aspects in her career. She came as a student and spent a long number of years studying the art. And while studying, she also participated in many of the choreographic works of Manaka and some other artists also, because she had gone through the collaborative attempt between Manaka and Robert de Rosier, or you were not in Robert, but you were in some other works. But many of the choreographic works, and Nina also has played heroine's role and very lead role in many works, such as Sitayana, for instance. He was Sita and so on. But Nina, of course, was born here, and therefore she's an Indo-Canadian. She straddles the two cultures. And for some of us who came, who were born and raised in one culture, although India, of course, is a multicultural land in any case, it becomes a very important question as to how does it feel to get into the spirit of a dance genre or any art that is developed in a different soil, and therefore it's kind of born under a different sky, because its past, its historical trajectory has been quite different, and therefore the signals that children get in one culture are often very different from the signals that you get from another culture. And that shapes your sensibilities and your worldview and so on. Now, with this background, I'm looking at Nina, a product of a Malayali family, but she was born in Toronto, brought up as a very brilliant sort of pursuits. Later on, we will see that she became very adept at the martial art of Kalaripayattu and so on. So I want to start with Nina and say, well, I want you to tell all of us, your growing up here, your taking to Indian dance, were you aware of the differences between Indian art and Western art, or ballet and modern here and Indian dances in India, or were they really foreign dances to you, and what you were seeing around you were the kind of your native dances? I just want to hear about the development of your own mind and your own perception, in which now you have become such beautiful interpreter of Indian dance.
Thank you, Rishish Bhai. Well, I myself, like many young Canadian-born South Asian students or children whose parents were immigrants to this country, initially at a very young age was put into Indian dance in hopes of grasping onto what little aspects of culture still remained, what they could being in Canada. So at a very young age, I was put into a dance class, kind of not knowing anything other than this was a little bit difficult, but it was also quite fun. And I think there's a part of me that, even though I might have realized that it was something very different, I didn't actually think that I was that different. I thought I was like everybody else until maybe we talk about different conversations with other classmates, like in school, they say they were taking jazz and ballet classes, and I said, I do dance too. I do Indian dance. And then questions of confusion usually followed. But it never really bothered me, because in my mind at that age, I felt I was the same as them. It was not until probably later on that I realized, oh, what I do is different. But I still never, I think that as it's probably because I was lucky enough to be a part of an institution that was so monumental and important in the Canadian diaspora to make me feel as important as those other dance schools that these classmates of mine were a part of. They were a part of big ballet schools, I was a part of a big Indian dance school. So I didn't feel inferior, which maybe some people do sometimes feel because they're constantly trying to justify their art. But I was always very proud at every cultural show at my public school. I was going to dance and I didn't think twice about it. I was very excited to get dressed up and love the attention I got from all the costume and jewelry and makeup I got to wear. So,
did you at any point think of taking ballet lessons or lessons in sort of art form which probably was more dominant art form, particularly among your own classmates and other friends? Did you ever feel that Indian dance was in some sense expected of you, and in that sense you felt duty bound to do Indian dance, but in your own way perhaps you might have chosen to go with the other students and friends of your school perhaps?
I think it's probably natural that many young dancers did feel that, but I, for some reason, I didn't. I don't know why. I felt that maybe a part of me thought that ballet was unattainable for some reason, or out of reach for me, because I didn't see other South Asian girls or young Indian girls taking ballet. So maybe that's part of the problem at that time, because we're talking quite over 25 years ago. So maybe that wasn't as common. So I didn't think that was even a possibility. But I never felt a void or the urge to want to do all those things, because I felt fulfilled enough in what I was doing. I recall very vividly, because I used to always have class on Fridays, and if I was sick or had a fever, I would pretend to my mom and dad that I wasn't sick so I wouldn't have to miss the class. So I was very like, no, I'm fine, it's not hot, I'm just sweating, you know, you know, make up any excuse to not miss class, because that was something that was the one thing they had, you know, poured into me to put as a part of the cultural experience for me. It was one of the few things. I mean, I was in a school, a public school, where in a class of 30, maybe there was 3 or 4 Indian students. So for me, you know, that was normal. But when I went to dance class, I was in a class with so many, and we were all friends, and it was just such a great experience. And it was something that I felt was difficult, but also challenging enough to make it interesting. So it fulfilled me in many ways, even as a child.
What did you like most when you were learning Indian dance? Because you were being introduced to a certain physical vocabulary. You also had to deal with songs and lyrics which were in a language other than English or French or whatever. And of course you were being told about sort of heroes and heroines and stories which were different. I'm sure at some point these stories were told perhaps also in another context. Maybe you had a religious occasion and you talked about gods and goddesses and so on and so forth. Did this all make you feel very acutely that somehow you were different? You were not quite the part of 40 students of your class. Maybe 5 of them were Indians, but you were different. And did it create at any point any uncomfortable feeling or uneasiness? I want to move on to dance itself very quickly, but this particular socio-cultural aspect of Indian dance is very important, because as Nina pointed out, parents also looked upon dance not so much as an art form. No, I'm not talking about all parents, but they looked upon dance as an important vehicle that would somehow bring Nina or a girl like that into the culture of India, into that whole religious and social background that the parents grew up with, and they wanted to instill that sense of being Indian. Not so much being Malayali, although perhaps you might have even gone to language classes at that point, you know. You enjoyed dance in its physicality, you enjoyed dance in its musicality, and so on and so forth. And therefore, of course, you enjoyed it, but you also developed a sense of perhaps a difference, because you were singing songs, English and French and whatever, and yet when it came to dance classes, it was not quite Hindi, perhaps. In Bharatanatyam, you often had to learn Tamil and Telugu songs and so on. Just a quick comment on this, and then I want to move on to actual dance and your training and so on.
So for me, I know, you know, being Malayali was a very rare thing for me in my day-to-day life. I always had to explain myself to, even within other South Asians at the time, there weren't as many of us here at that time. But when I came to a dance class, there would be a Tamil-speaking girl, a Malayali-speaking girl, a Gujarati girl, you know, and sometimes someone who didn't speak any Indian languages. So we all really bonded, I think, on that aspect, because we, even though we were slightly different, we were all Canadian-born, you know, so but we are all South Asian. So I think the bond of that unity that we felt in dance class was something very important for us. And that was a part of our cultural experience. And I didn't have a very strong, or I didn't have a lot of knowledge in terms of religious aspects and things like that. I never really learned so much. Everything I learned was through dance. All my stories of all religious texts, all those stories, I learned through dance. And anything I didn't know, if I learned it in a dance, I used to go and try to find out more about it. So for me, it was a huge experience of learning, not just the languages, but the epics, the text, things I didn't know at all. And all of my knowledge actually comes from it. So I was able to not just gain a cultural experience, but like languages. I was exposed to all these languages because so many of the songs came from so many different languages, and texts like the Mahabharata, the Ramayana, all those things that I would have never probably been exposed to otherwise, other than maybe having a book on my shelf in my home somewhere that I didn't bother picking up and reading, or you know, or watching the odd television serial or something. So this was really an outlet of major learning for me for so many aspects, beyond just the dance.
Did you ever think you would become a dancer, that you would adopt a dancing career? Was that ever a career option in your mind? Or you always thought that it was so cute, so nice, you enjoyed it, but ultimately your path lay in being a doctor or a lawyer or a journalist or a teacher and so on. Was there ever a conflict? Was there ever a dream of becoming a dancer? Because you right now maintain sort of several careers. You are a dancer, and I can say you are going to remain a dancer, evolve into a more mature dancer, but you have other careers and interests. But was it ever a career option as such? I'll come to this point a little later once again, but let me just throw this back to you.
So, quite honestly, as being in the younger years of learning, I never thought it was an option. Because we felt like such a minority of people who were practicing an art form that was not mainstream. My role model was definitely Menakadi, of course. Yeah, because she was the one who made us realize that there was a life, you could sustain your life on an art form. But we thought we had to be as good as her to do that. And we thought that that path was an impossible one. And we didn't know until later on in life, when I come to understand the dance world, and that through funding agencies like the Canada Council and Ontario Art Council, like these options were available to everyone, and not just the ballet companies and the contemporary dance companies, that there was ways to financially sustain yourself as a dancer, because that was always the concern. Would you be able to support yourself? Or because, you know, many of our families, of course, came to this country to give us more financial freedom. So then, luckily, I have very supportive parents who said, whatever it is you want to do, as long as you do it with conviction and passion, it's fine. So I did take a path in a different career, but I always came back to wanting to do something in dance. And I always felt a void when I stepped away from it or even thought about stepping away from it. It was always a feeling of deep sadness. So I think that when the option of it was being possibly taken away is when I felt like, no, it needs to stay. So, and then I realized through the years, I mean, thankfully, I was a part of an institution that not only exposed me to just Indian dance, I was exposed to so many different types of dance. So that was a huge reason why I felt like there were options too, because if you initially we felt isolated otherwise when you're just taking class, but then after joining the company and taking workshops with so many important artists that come from all different genres of dance and performing with them on the same stage and rehearsing with them and things like that, that really opened my, as in they, in their world, there's many who follow, pursue their career in dance. So then I'm like, oh, there are options for us too. We are just as important artists as they are. And I think that's when it really flipped a switch for me, that it was a viable career and it is supportive.
So what do you think, where did Kalanidhi International Festival come into the picture? Because as you are describing, you were growing up, you were looking at several different possibilities around you, and of course you had glimpses of ballet and modern dance, and Bharatnatyam of course was your main genre, but at what age or when exactly did you become aware of, say, 8 classical styles of India, like not Bharatnatyam only, but Odissi and Kathak and Kathakali and so on and so forth, and you found, well, I will let you speak about how Kalanidhi Fine Arts that brought dancers, Indian dance, seemingly or apparently Indian dancers from around the diaspora. They came from England and France and Australia, and all this must have expanded your vision. Probably you were overwhelmed at some point. What is this Indian dance? But my God, so many different styles, so many different dances. Tell me a little more about when you really came in touch with Kalanidhi's presentation of international dance artists and companies, and what it did to you.
So I recall probably a few years after I started at the school, one of the first Kalanidhi festivals, I believe it was 93 or 1993.
1993 we actually started it.
Yeah, so I recall coming to the first Kalanidhi festival and being a young, you know, 9-year-old or something, 12-year-old, and being completely blown away that look at this fancy theater and this really important venue and event, and they were all Indian dancers there. And to me, it didn't take very long to realize that it was a really big deal, that Indian dance was not just something that was going to be brushed aside as some kind of recreational art form, that it really did have a deep-rooted history and technique and extensive training, and especially even across all the classical styles. So that was, at the time, they were only talking about 4 or 5 classical styles. It was only later that we talked about 6, 7, 8. And every time, the only reason my first exposure was always the Kalanidhi festivals. The first time I ever got to see it live was each Kalanidhi festival. And every time we would leave feeling really energized and inspired that these artists could create work and we didn't have to go all the way to India to watch it. So that was a huge deal, because my family, the majority of them actually live in India, and when I tell them, oh yes, I saw so and so perform, and I saw, you know, I took workshops with Sujata Mohapatra, and I'm in her Gita Govinda production as her Sakhi, they're just amazed, because for them to even be able to take a class, they'd have to go all the way to Bhubaneswar, and you know, it's a really big ordeal. But we were lucky enough to have her come right into the same studio we were coming to every week, and going to the theater right down the street where we could watch the festival we were going to attend anyway, and we could see five dance styles in one night, which was a rare thing to be able, and all high caliber, high quality artists. So at a young age, I started to really feel proud and I felt like I was representing that, even though I had a very small part in it by taking classes, or, you know, I was like, oh, they do what I do. I'm going to be like them one day, you know. So that's how I feel Kalanidhi shaped us.
I go back to those years when Manaka and myself and Sudha, the real heart and soul of Kalanidhi Festival, we were discussing how best to teach Indian dance here and how to give the girls a good sense of and a connection with India, Indian ways of teaching, Indian ways of learning, and so on. So I think Manaka and Sudha also, Sudha invited so many dancers, Manaka invited gurus who actually came here and would teach for a month or 2 months, and so on and so forth. So your world expanded slowly but surely, and then you began to feel that sense of connection with India. I think that is what a lot of people have told us, that Kalanidhi made a very important contribution in giving a much wider sense of Indian dance, because Indian dance was really growing at that point. Even within India, Indian dance was looking for different ways of expressing itself. You came in contact with what whom we call now contemporary Indian dancers. Do you recall when you began to think in terms of a real distinction, if at all, between the traditional Indian dance and its world, maybe of kings and queens or gods and goddesses, and a whole very richly developed and richly populated world of dance with the stories, and what was presented in Kalanidhi festivals as the contemporary dance of, say, Chandralekha or Daksha Sheth and so on. I just want you to recall, I just want you to go back to that moment when you suddenly, maybe you felt confused. Is this really Indian dance? It doesn't, you know. When did you, in your mind, begin to think in terms of a distinction and yet there is a continuity, or how did you look upon the contemporary Indian dance?
I think I speak for many of us who perhaps are born and raised, or at least raised in this country, and grew up learning Indian dance, that instantly when we see contemporary work done by, from a South Asian context, we are connected to it because we feel like that's us. We are one foot in this North American culture and one foot in South Asian culture. So instantly, I always felt very drawn to it because it spoke to my worlds colliding. You know, outside of our dance classes and dance company and all that, we were exposed to all these other things in our everyday life, in our school life, in our media life, watching television, you know, all those things. So whenever I personally saw those connections happen, I was very drawn to it because I saw aspects of the things that I had learned and aspects of things that I had witnessed throughout my years of growing up in this country, which was always really, really fascinating. Whether it be as subtle as costumes or the use of gestures or the use of the sensibility of the movements, something always spoke to me because I know how those movements felt, but then I also was intrigued by how they maybe twisted those or took a new outlook on it and made it into something of their own.
Yeah, Well, in a sense, I grew up with you, although at a much older age. we were growing up with a difference of maybe 30, 40 years between us. But I felt a similar thing because I came with a background in South Asian dance, and I recall my own days at, on the campus of the University of Rochester when I saw Merce Cunningham of the contemporary dance, and I was shocked and bewildered as to what is this dance really, and so on. But then slowly you begin to see the connections, you begin to see that dance in seemingly what seems to be not quite dance in Indian sense or that sort of norms of beauty would differ, and so on. You saw Danny Grossman, and you saw Robert de Rosier and Manuka's collaboration with them. So that moment was, in a sense, a defining moment when you began to see that is, there's much more to dance and human body and human expressive ways of emotions than must just Indian dance. And it gave you a sense of strength that there was far more than Indian dance that you would be interested in, or you felt that this was pretty confusing. Well, the worlds are different. Now, I just want to come to your present state, because you recently got a grant from Ontario Arts Council. You had worked with in Manuka's productions, and you were actually the dancer, the rehearsal director for some of them. Manuka's productions often have been called neoclassical, or sort of moving from classical into the contemporary. But I want you to tell me about your own physical experience of this contemporary dance. Not only in learning the movements of martial arts like Kalaripayattu, you can tell us a little about Kalaripayattu and the training you got in our school and your participation, but your own experiments with what may be called effusion. For want of a better word, I will use that word. I would like you to tell us about your own participation in, say, Natasha's choreography, say Riaz, where your body was being put to different ways of moving, different movements, or the familiar gestures, but treated rather differently. I think I would really like to hear that moment from you.
So I think our first... We'd had, you know, a few intensive with different contemporary dancers and workshops and things, but the first choreographic experience was with Natasha doing her piece Riaz. So initially we were quite nervous, understandably, about what it would entail, because we had seen her contemporary work and saw the intense physicality involved in her work, but also saw the aspects of the same South Asian dance training that was so apparent in her work. So there was a mix of excitement and fear, looking forward to being challenged, which we were definitely, because the process was very different than what we normally would go through. She would give us tasks and ask us questions and say, you know, give me a line of a Tilana that you enjoy, and now put it on the floor, you know, things like that we've never really done before. Although it was intimidating at first, eventually we became very comfortable and excited to be able to have that aspect and the freedom to do those things. So I think for us, that's the thing that I think we excelled in as well, because we came from something that was so, had a large vocabulary that was very clear. And at first we're like, are we allowed to change these this way? Is it allowed? But once we got into it, we realized that it was quite interesting because what was coming out of it was very unique, and still stayed true to the form whenever it was used, but also still took it to a new place that was still very beautiful, and also physically demanding this in a different way. But still let us use our many years of training in the art form to its full capacity, not just an aspect, not just throwing a hand gesture in here and there. It was very much still very much a classical piece to us, even though it wasn't. So I think that's something that we all really connected to, because that's who we were, you know, people who saw our art form as one way, but were curious also to see where it would go from there, what you could do with that, such a huge vocabulary of all these hand gestures, all these steps, all these movements, all these body positions. So that's why I think how we felt.
Your guru, Manikar, teaches at the National Ballet School, and that is where the dance vocabulary of Bharatanatyam and dance vocabulary, or the body conditioning that precedes in ballet training also, they really come in real contact with each other. And I suppose it's a common experience among people like you or Manika or others, that if a body is well conditioned and well developed in one style, but really well developed, where you've gone right into the depth of that body movement, how it arises, the anatomical structure of the body, and so on, so it becomes possible to go or to take your body from one inherited style of moving into another. I'm going to ask you, although I have to be mindful of the time also, because although I want to make this interview very informal and unrestricted in some sense, because we want to really bring out the real feelings and issues, but again, still I'll have to be mindful of time. We can meet another time, because in this pre-festival period, where we really want to engage with the audience and with ourselves, I think we really want to be free. Anyway, I want to ask you about where are you going now? Where do you go with all these various different experiences and different possibilities which are before you?
For me, as we talked about, many of us took different career paths in addition to our dance. So I had a strong interest in kinesiology and physiotherapy and things like that, and physical rehab. And then that also naturally happened from my dance training because of the awareness of the body. And I had the opportunity to, with Manikadi, every year to go teach at the National Ballet and watch these dancers try to learn Bharatanatyam essentially in its pure form. So actually I went later, many years later, went back to York to do my master's in dance, which I, through my experiences at the National Ballet, did my thesis on the Adamundi, which is also called the plié in ballet, and the training methods that we use to attain a good Adamundi versus the training methods they use to attain a plié. So I attended hours and hours of ballet classes there and spoke to many of the teachers about the methods they used to train that, and the methods, and I shared with the methods we used, and it was an incredible experience, because although we were trying to attain the same position, we went about it in different ways, but essentially the outcome was the same.
This is just a comment or a question. I was always struck very early in my watching of dance, the similarity between plié and aramandi, of course. But a better understanding of Bharatanatyam or watching shows that you, aramandi is used as a form of, I mean, a position of body in which you actually dance. I think in plié position, the feeling is you don't dance in plié position, but it's a position that's a kind of a take-off position, and therefore you go into it, maybe to come out of it, to jump out of it. Well, you may comment on this. So I think the physicality of plié and aramandi must therefore be quite different, because in one aramandi you have to sustain movements.
Yes, that's exactly it. The one, I guess, take home that I got from it was that for us, we do sustain the aramandi for extended periods of time. And for us, we have a real sense of grounding. But for most of the ballet training, it's a position that they're passing through, or is something that they don't necessarily maintain for extended periods of time. But there are aspects of that training which benefit us. This concept of pulling up in the aramandi, even though you're going deep. So those things really helped when I applied it to the Bharatanatyam training. And vice versa, when I shared with many of the teachers at the National Ballet about some of the things that we do, they were really quite fascinated. And it was a really beautiful exchange of training methods. So I think that's one thing. Another thing that probably years ago I would never would have thought that we could ever mutually benefit from each other, which was eye-opening for both of us, which I think is one of the many reasons why Manakali is invited every year back to teach there, because so much. 22 years, exactly, yeah. So I think that's part of, although we are doing seemingly different art forms, I was very fascinated by the connections that we had that were similar, which is what which drew me to that topic. But to answer your question, I did, luckily, very much with great surprise, but received the Chalmers Art Fellowship grant to pursue basically freely some experimentation on things that maybe over the years of watching and performing and learning would allow me the opportunity to experiment without necessarily the pressure of having to perform or produce a show or anything like that, which is kind of always the fear of venturing into something new. So I will hopefully be doing three mini projects through that. The first would be to use a group of Bharatanatyam trained dancers to experiment with, I guess, neoclassical, some contemporary type of work, which is what I'm hoping to do. Just the freedom of being in a studio and experimenting to see if that type of path and choreography is something that would interest me. The second is with Ravi Jain of Why Not Theatre. I've seen Ravi's work on many occasions. I think we actually went together, I was quite fascinated by the mime and physical theater aspect of his work. And we had many conversations about the similarities between abhinaya and the mime vocabulary and the many different types of mime that he is trained in. So we've always talked about, you know, what would happen if we brought those two worlds into a studio and experimented with something that's a text that may not be necessarily done by either side, like Shakespeare's Macbeth or something of that sort. So it's really just the freedom to experiment. And the third project would be with the help of Nova Bhattacharya, we will try to see if I could experiment on myself to create a solo, if need be, or maybe a duet, something that I've always kind of shied away from because I find comfort in dancing in a group setting. But this is the three.
I know you had some experience with choreography itself, because I remember Kathana Kutuhalam Raga was selected. I mean, the famous Balamuralli Krishna's Kathana Kutuhalam, and you and three or four other girls actually choreographed, and Menka encouraged you to do that so that we had also put it up in our final performance. How far do you visualize yourself as a choreographer? Of course, right now we are performer, and you are going to perform in the upcoming festival. I want to talk very quickly a little about your role in the upcoming festival, because many of our people in the audience, either they have watched you or they are going to watch you, and I want to establish a connection between this beautifully draped sitting lady with the dancing girl that you have seen or you are going to see. We are going to show a clip of your dance work. But tell me a little more about your choreographic aspirations.
So for many years, I always felt comfort in just being the dancer. And I think maybe has something to do with my new role into motherhood that maybe brought out, yes, well, exactly. Well, that really made me feel like, you know, I should really try to see if there's a path there for me so that I don't have to necessarily give up the physical aspect of the dance, because I'm hoping I can do it forever, but you never know, you know. And I do want to do all those things that I've thought about doing but never really, you know, went ahead with it. So I, after having a son, I was like, the time is now. You know, it's now or never. So it's kind of where I was pushed to do it, because I thought, you know, is he ever going to see me dance? I don't know, you know. And if not, at least he should see something that I maybe choreographed. So it was those motivations that really, I think, really pushed me in the last couple of years to want to make sure that I do something to show my own child. So I think that's where my motivation started. I don't know whether anyone will enjoy my choreography, but I'd like to at least be given an opportunity to try and see. Yes. Our choreography of Kathana Kutuhalam was an incredible experience for us. We had to go from even recording the music to creating the entire dance, which was, you know, for us challenging, much more challenging than we thought it would be, but also really exciting to see it come together. And we often debated and argued about the choreographic positions and things like that, but we were all informed by all the intricate choreographies we learned through MTDC and through Manikadi. So, and also informed by all the contemporary work that we had seen and the workshops with the people that we've encountered from all different aspects of dance. So they've all informed us in so many ways that's beyond the just the traditional work. So naturally, I feel like we feel like there's something else that we could possibly come out of this. So that's where my aspirations are. I love theater as well. I just, something draws me to theater as well. So I'd love to see those worlds collide, but also see the contemporary world collide as well.
I would like you to tell us a little more about your role in the upcoming festival. You're part of a group, a choreography, but just as you referred to, you know, the kind of neoclassical elements that you find in Manika's work, well, they are going to be reflected. Tell the audience about that work. Why should they come to watch you and your friends in the Latangi Varnam? and talk about the choreographic aspect, and also the whole aspect of this, what may be called a new approach to choreography, group choreography.
So I think traditionally people view Varnam as a very long solo piece where the pure dance is weaved between lines of Abhinaya, and it goes on for an extended period of time with one dancer on stage. This is a completely different approach to that. For one, it's seven dancers, and although we still keep all the elements of the Varnam, it is a new way of approaching choreographic ways. If one dancer is in a corner doing the literal translation that perhaps a solo dancer would do, the other six will be downstage reenacting that same story, which is something you don't usually see. So it's quite a unique approach to making the Varnam reach more people and being more easily understood by everyone, regardless of your dance training or dance background or exposure. And I think...
painting, because her initial degree was in drawing and painting, and there how you are using the space of a canvas, but here you are using the entire space of the stage, the proscenium stage. And the question is, well, in a solo tradition of Bharatanatyam, you will concentrate on one dancing body and therefore one sort of a point in space, but here you are dealing with so many different points in spaces. How do you connect them to still retain the geometrical sense of design of, you know? So I think you referred to this, that it's a new way of approach. And I think this is what you people also adopted very successfully in Kathmandu Halam
Karyam. Yeah, so one of the, it's one thing to take a group and put them in, let's say, a V and let them do the whole dance. That's one way of doing it, but that we would never do that. In many of these choreographies, that would do an aspect of it, which is something and very intricate. And for dancers who are, it's quite complex, and it takes a lot of time and effort to make sure that everyone is in their respective places. And it's also about awareness of the space, having the dance understood inside and out, backwards and forwards. So that's, I find, the most challenging and the most rewarding part of watching it. Because no matter how many times you've watched it, every time you've gained a new aspect of it that you didn't see before. Even as we rehearse, I'm like, oh, I just noticed we're in this really neat formation, you know, that kind of thing. So it happens even for us while we're doing it. So I think that's what makes it quite unique.
Tangi. In fact, I think Nina learned it about 4 or 5 years ago, and you have performed it on several occasions. It was quite delightful to watch the other day that you have become such a powerful rehearsal director, because you were teaching other girls this time, you know, and so. So that is one reason why you should come Saturday night to watch Latangi Varnam with Nina and seven other girls. And this time, Dinaka's company have been integrated or involved in this Varnam. So that is a very powerful reason why you should come and watch this Varnam. There are many other aspects of Nina's dance career and theater that she has talked about. I would have liked to go deeper into it, and I still will find some other occasion in the still waiting 12 days or 11 days that we may come back. But right now, I'm going to show you a dance in which Nina actually dances, and I guess Dashanarthanam. So you will get sense of Nina's own dance and dancing ability. You will also get the sense of this choreography, where space is divided and again stitched back in a very different way. Come and watch Nina and seven other girls on Saturday, April 1st. And as I said, I really want to pull back Nina once again into another interview. Just before we end, I must tell you, Nina, forget to talk about the dramatic sequence that occurs right in the beginning of Latangi Varnam. I wonder who wrote it.
So for in previous occasions that we have performed this particular Varnam, we do this kind of informal humorous skit, which involves us dancers pretending to warm up on the stage in preparation for a very physically demanding and complex Varnam, and secretly informing the audience of the stories that they are about to see. Through secrecy, without letting Manakadi know, because she always says that our dance should be so effective, we don't need to tell the audience the story, which is is where we break the wall between performer and student and just regular girls who are in a studio dancing. So it's a nice switch once we go back into the actual performance, when everyone goes into their performer zone. And that, of course, was written by Rishish Bhai. Amongst many of our productions, actually.
Okay, I guess thank you all, and thank you, Nina, first of all. And as I said, I promise we'll bring Nina back before the end of this pre-festival period. So thank you very much. Thank you. Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you. and form.
भजमन राम चरण सुखदाई हे भजमन राम चरण सुखदाई भजमन राम चरण सुखदाई हे भजमन राम चरण जी चरण से किसी सुरसरी शंकर जटा समान जी चरणन से किसी सुरसरी शंकर जटा जटाशंकरी नाम पर्यो है जटाशंकरी नाम पर्यो है त्रिभुवन तारण आई भजमन राम चरण राम चरण सुखदाई जिन चरणन की चरण पादुका भरत रहो लवला जिन चरणन की चरण पादुका भरत रहो लवला सोई चरण के वत धोईली सोई चरण के वत धोईली तब हरि नाम चला भजमन राम चरण सुखदाई हे भजमन राम चरण दंडक वन प्रभु पावन की हो मिटाई दंडक वन प्रभु पावन कीनो ऋषियन त्रास मिटाई सोई प्रभु त्रिलो स्वामी सोए प्रभु त्रिलोक के स्वामी कनक मृग संगधाए वजमन राम चरण सुखदाय हे भजमन राम चरण सुखदाय शिव सन का ब्रह्मादिक शेष सहस मुख गाए शिव सन का दिक अरु ब्रह्मादिक शेष सहस मुख गाए तुलसीदास मरुत सुत की प्रभु तुलसीदास मरुत सुत की प्रभु निज मुख करत बढ़ाए भज मन चरण सुखदाई भज मन राम चरण सुखदाई भज मन राम चरण सुखदाई हे भज मन राम चरण
selflessly Sudhaben has served the art and left her mortal body immersed with the God in heaven, but in spirit she is with all of us, inspiring smilingly to support us and bless us in our future endeavor. I am very happy to perform and give her the Nrityanjali and seeking her blessings in my future endeavor. I hope her spirit and light will guide us and bless us and show us the path of divinity where we all selflessly devote ourselves and become one with the divine art. Thank you.
we are going to continue to watch various examples of Indian dance from Kalanidhi's archival footage. And therefore, now we take you to another very great internationally renowned dancer, Sujata Mohapatra, who is really a top-ranking dancer of Odissi style. Sujata performed for Kalanidhi Festival at least 3 to 4 times in the past, and we are going to the performance that she presented in 2013 at Kalanidhi Festival. She's going to perform a Pallavi, which is a form of pure dance, nritya, in Odissi style. Sujata is also going to perform at the upcoming festival on Thursday night, 30th of March. She's also going to perform a little piece on 28th of March, the very opening night after Menka performs her Karna Kunti of Tagore. But then she is also she's going to perform on 30th of March. And that whole evening is going to be the Odissi evening. So that right in the beginning, Sujata will give us about 40 minutes of a Abhinaya piece that was developed by Guru Keluchan Mahapatra. It comes from Tulasi Ramayana. And then she will be followed by a Odissi choreographic work based upon the poet Jaidev's Gita Govindam of the 12th century. And Menaka put this together and choreographed a number of things, but it is also very strongly based upon the choreography of individual Ashtapadis by Guru Keluchar Mahapatra. So it's a combination of Menaka and Guru Keluchar Mahapatra, but then use other art forms such as the painting particularly, because Gita Govindam had inspired a large number of painters, and particularly of painters of the Kangra Valley, 18th century painters of the Kangra Valley at the court of King Hasan Sargent. They are some of the most lyrical, some of the most beautiful moving paintings on the theme of Gita Govindam. And what Menaka has done is to get a whole visual design as the backdrop that keeps us Gita Govindam took place. And there is the beautiful music, beautiful dance. It's the whole story of Gita Govindam. And we have tried to maintain the musicality and beauty of the Sanskrit language so that there's going to be a narration not only in English to move the story forward and for the audience to keep track of it, but we are also going to have Sanskrit narration or the reciting of the original Sanskrit poetry so that we can give an idea of the sounds of the Sanskrit language to the audience. Please come and watch both Sujata in her 40-minute solo recital followed by Gita Govindam of the 18th century. And a number of dancers will be performing there. Sujata once again is the lead dancer in the role of Radha in Gita Govindam. 30th March at Fleck Dance Theater. Thank you. Yeah, the tickets, well, I'm going to talk a little more about tickets in general at the end of the dancing. Let's just watch this piece, which is an example of Sujata's own artistry. Thank you.
Thank you.
madani 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 ni ni dani 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 sa 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 sagare sani re sani da sani da mani da maga da magare magare sagare sa 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 Kamada madani tani sa sari sagare sani ni sani re sani da mada mani da maga de gari magare sa 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 ni da
That was Sujata Mahapatra, one of the foremost Odissi dancers of today. And that was the dance that you saw, which she had performed in 2013, Kalanidhi Festival. This was, of course, to give you a glimpse into Sujata's artistry. She's going to be dancing Odissi this time. Obviously, it is not the same piece that you'll see, but this will give you an idea about the level and the height of her artistry. So once again, I'd invite you to watch Sujata once again on the 30th of March at the festival. We are going to continue with these other dances drawn from Kalanidhi's archival footage. But before we do that, I also want to make a certain announcement about the prices, ticket prices for the festival. Again, to remind you that there are three modes of watching, and at the festival you will watch either at Fleck Dance Theatre live dance on stage, although that also is going to be mixed with some live stream dance from other places such as New Delhi and so on. But primarily the Fleck Dance Theatre will give you live dancing danced on the stage. At the same time, there'll be live streaming of that very dance to other locations in the city, particularly the Woodside Cinema in Scarborough, and hopefully there'll be some Cineplex location, but I'm not going to talk about it now. At these locations where you watch on a white screen at a cinema house such as Woodside, the prices are going to be different. It's a different mode of watching, and it will be increasingly the way we want to present dance here. So the transition from live dancing on the physical stage to watching dance on a white screen, live streamed or encore streamed, that transition we want to begin to appreciate. But it is not a complete withdrawal of one mode of watching and installation of another. It is both, and one can choose which way one wants to watch this time. There's a third mode, and that is home viewing of live stream dance, and that has a different price altogether. So you can watch it in the comfort and privacy of your own homes, on your private devices, such as a laptop, computer, and a smartphone or whatever. There is one very happy announcement I want to make, and that is that now that we are almost 10 days or 12 days away from the festival, we have decided to make it possible for a still larger number of people to buy tickets, and therefore we are reducing the prices at all levels. So at Fleck Dance Theatre, where a single price is $38 for a single ticket, now it is going to be reduced to $27. At the same time, there will be a reduction in the seven shows pass. The pass until now was at $175 for all seven shows, but now that is going to be reduced to $126. This will make it possible for a number of people who were denied the watching of the show, but we really wish that we could bring our dance to a very large number of people, so we are trying to attract those people by reduction prices. At the level of the live streaming, we are going to reduce the price from $20 a single ticket to $15. I'll talk a little more about it even tomorrow when I'll give you more details on the price reduction, but the price reduction will be in effect from tomorrow. There is another thing that I would like to announce, and that is, at these open houses every day, or if not every day, very frequently, we are going to have lucky draws, and the winners will, of course, free tickets. So tonight we are going to make the beginning, and that is for only five draws. We are going to have five draws where the winners will get free admission. We want to include everyone, those who are present here in the theater and those who are watching from home, from distant locations. Those who are at home should send us an email with their names so that we know that we can include you by your name. And therefore, on the tickets which are going to be drawn on the papers on which the numbers are written for those who will pick the papers, and then we will put them back in a jar so that we can draw them. Similarly, for those who are at home, they can send us an email at the address admin@kalanidhifineArts.org. Again, admin, A-D-M-I-N, at Kalanidhi, K-A-L-A-N-I-D-H-I, FineArts, F-I-N-E-A-R-T-S. It is one word, KalanidhiFineArts.org. We shall then write your name or the email address on the piece of paper, and when the drawing takes place, it will be either by names or numbers, but those who are sort of participating through other locations, their names or numbers will be written. That will identify the winner immediately. The draw will take place at the end of all these dance sequences. So we'll get back to dancing once again. And for a change, we want to take you to another dance number, which is called Riyaz, sort of practice, choreographed by Natasha Bhakta, who was our own Manaka student and dancer in Manaka's company for a number of years. And she has blossomed into a beautiful contemporary dancer that combines her Indian foundation, the foundation of in Indian dance, with her training in other forms of movements. So she's rated as a very, almost a front rank contemporary dancer, and we are very proud of Natasha's works. Manaka had invited Natasha into our own company to choreograph on our present dancers of the company. And the result was this beautiful piece called Riyaz. I think it was actually choreographed a few years ago. It was presented at the Kalanidhi Festival, and you are going to watch as it was done. I believe it was 2011. No, even, okay, I'm not quite sure when it was done. I forget the date. I'm sorry. We are showing the 2013 version, where the dancers are from Manikataka Dance Company, the basically Bharatanatyam dancers, but now they are going to do this contemporary movements and a whole piece by Natasha Bhakt, Riyaz. Thank you. Thank you. that was Riyaz by Natasha Bakht. And clearly, the foundation in Bharatanatyam movements was quite obvious, but it was a contemporary way of moving the body and even the contemporary way of choreographing. This is important for all of you to realize, because we are going to have Friday night of the festival devoted to contemporary Indian dance. Riyaz of Natasha is not included for that evening, but it sort of gives you a look into what contemporary choreographers do. And there's a whole diversity, there's a whole variety, so that what you'll see on Friday night will be quite different from Natasha's approach to contemporary choreography, where Indian dance is involved or Indian dance movements are involved. I think all these things will come up for discussion on Sunday when we have the symposium on the issues in contemporary dance, in Indian dance. We are now going to go back to the traditional dance, Kathak, and we are going to present Sheila Mehta of Mumbai, but now she lives in New York and partly even in Toronto. She is going to present beautiful Kathak dance. One of the ways in which Sheila Mehta's Gujarati inheritance comes forth in Kathak is, not that you are going to see it now, but I have to make this particular part of her choreography or part of her work very clear to you, that she has tried to go into the Gujarati sort of folk dance and the folk traditions and tried to bring it into Kathak, and that she has successfully done. What is called Charana Sahitya, that is brought into Kathak dance. We are going to show you some glimpses of it, not in this festival, but a little later, a whole new development in Kathak dance. So let's go back to the traditional Kathak by Sheila Mehta. Thank you.
Thank you. ஜெகனுக்கு வேறுபை நயன பழக்க கோலி நயன பழக்க கோலி நயன பழக்க கோலி.
Thank you. Oh,
my instrument. And I have done all that I could. Now I ask, has the time come at last when I may go in and see your face? And offer you my silent salutation. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was Kathak dance by Sheila Mehta of Mumbai and also of New York and Toronto, where she now spends a good deal of time. We are going to close our dance sequences with a last number from Santosh Nair's choreography called Mystical Forest. Mystical Forest is also going to be shown at the upcoming 16th Kalanidhi Festival on Friday night, 31st of March. But that is going to be the full version, 55 minutes, whereas what we are trying to do is to show you an excerpt, only 10 minutes long, but that will give you a sense of the look and feel of this dance by, this choreography by Santosh Nair. We term it contemporary. It is really, it will have a very different look and feel from Kathak or Maha or Bharatanatyam or Odissi. It is actually that the whole vocabulary is derived from Chow dance. And now Chow has been accepted as part of the classical genre in Indian dance, but it's very recent, one might say. It wasn't always considered part of the classical dance heritage of India. I would like you to look at this excerpt and decide, at least in its essentiality, you will see contemporary dance of Santosh Nair. So let's watch 10-minute excerpt. I'll have far more to say at the festival, because Santosh is also going to be a participant in the symposium on contemporary dance. You are also going to see Santosh's other work, Game of Dice, on the very first night of the festival. And the two put together will give you a certain sense of where Santosh has been going. He has been changing and experimenting with other ways of bringing out contemporariness. And I think we'll also hear from him at the symposium about the new trend that has been set in India about a kind of official version of contemporary dance. And I have asked Santosh to elaborate that and bring out a sense of the whole movement that has emerged in India in recent months. Let's watch an excerpt of Mystical Forest.
Thank you.
Well, that was the final dance of the evening, Mystical Forest, an excerpt from a much larger production that you'll see on 31st of March at the festival. That work will be about 55 minutes. This was just a 10-minute excerpt. And we showed it here so that you'll get some idea as to what Santosh's work looks like and what goes under the name of contemporary dance, at least in some part of it. It's not the whole gamut of contemporary dance at all, but a very important part of it. Now, we were going to make the draws for lucky tickets, and I regret to say that we did not have any participation. Looks like people don't like free tickets. Okay, now I understand what to do or what not to do. So I guess we are going to have to close this evening, and we'll meet tomorrow morning once again at 12 o'clock. And as I have said in the beginning, please come and listen to the interview on Kathak dance, the traditional Kathak, something that we don't see very often these days, something so magical that it needs to be seen to be believed. And we have Kasturi Mishra of Ottawa, who can be said to be the custodian of that tradition, or very passionately she advocates for its propagation and practice. The night that it will be presented at the festival by Kasturi with four musicians, that night is the second night of the festival, the 29th of March. And again, I hope that you'll come to watch it. It will be juxtaposed by the Kathak work of Deepthi Gupta. And that is why we have called that night Kathak in Transition. It will be very interesting to watch both of them in juxtaposition and also to hear what they have to say. They may not say much that evening, but once again, we shall take up this particular theme on Sunday as part of the symposium on issues in contemporary dance. So I thank you very much for watching this. And tomorrow we'll have perhaps a little more interesting and more varied and longer dance fair that we shall present to you. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.